Thank you, Carl,
and
for taking
if
care
I
of that.
Can let myself do a little bit of advertising now, because I think this is not my talk, but nevertheless, it's a very, very interesting talk, and please stay, and you will see the best, I think, the best possible data that harm reduction works. And now we are not talking about prevalence. Prevalence is important, but we are talking about what really matters, and that's death and disease. So here we have his talk. And he has no conflict. In the beginning of the 60s, we started to know. There was the Royal College of Physicians report, and there was a US Surgeon General. And Sweden, at that time, in terms of tobacco, we had snus already 1920. Snus has been for several hundreds of years. The reason that it was still on the market around 1960 is probably that Sweden was not part of any of the two world wars, where soldiers, men were fed free of charge with cigarettes, and all other old tobacco habits was going down the drain. But in Sweden, there was a rest left. And when this information was coming, Sweden was creating a clearinghouse for anti-tobacco information, and the head of that clearinghouse was actually Lars Ramström, the author of this speech. So we see that snus was going down, but around here it was turning and going up. And the information, as I mentioned, was one thing. Another thing was also that we in Sweden started to have very strong anti-smoking groups that was asking for smoke-free places. And then the Swedish tobacco monopoly, as it was at the time, started to advertise, you can enjoy tobacco without blowing smoke on your bystander. So that's probably started also to switch people to ask for this peculiar product, snus, which was loose snus at the time. It wasn't in bags. And it was usually farmers and loggers and miners and that kind of persons that used it. So how did the increasing use of snus influence the smoking habits? I will mostly concentrate on the male here, because they are the ones that use snus more than females. So in 1963, you see, we were never up to the very high numbers that they had in the war countries, like UK, 70-80%. We topped at around 49, and then it went down, and now we are something like 5-6 or whatever. Snus use was 9% in the 70s and increased to 20 and has stayed relatively stable, and I think it's 18 today also. The women, they were smoking less and they were also using snus less. So smoking down and snus up. If we look at cohorts, so those who were born in the 40s would be myself, then initiation of tobacco with smoking was very common, 55%, but snus was less than 10%. And we see then the initiation to a tobacco habit with snus has increased over the cohorts, and initiation to tobacco where you start with cigarettes has gone down. So that's encouraging and should be good for the health. And we also see that no initiation of any tobacco product has actually increased. So today there are those who were born in the 1980s, 60% of them have never touched a tobacco product. And here it was 35%. So despite we have snus that to a certain extent has replaced cigarettes, the total amount of tobacco used has also gone down. Boys, we are looking at proportion initiating daily smoking. Among those without any snus use, it's 46%, and with those with initial daily snus use, it's only 17%. So that's a good figure, and the same magnitude for girls. How has snus influenced smoking cessation? Can this be determined by comparing subgroups of ever daily smokers with different snus experiences? Let's try. So if we look at those who have smoked sometime during their life, and we look at continued daily smoking at the time of the survey, we see that 40% of those with no uptake of snus were smoking, while those with initial uptake of snus, that was 13%. And if we go to quit all smoking, those who had no uptake of snus, 55%, but those who had uptake with snus, 76% have given up smoking there. It actually becomes more clear with the next couple of pictures where we look at the ways people have tried to help themselves in Sweden. So this is some data here. We have men here. I'm going to concentrate on men. So we have nicotine gum here. The question is, what have they used in their last quit attempt? So 16% use nicotine gum, 12% nicotine patch, 51% snus, 8% others, and 13% combination of something. The figure in green, that's the efficacy of the product, so which is 0.4 here, 0.3, and 0.7, and a little lower here. So we tend to see that among men, at least, snus is the commonest smoking cessation product and also the most effective one. For women, snus is being used only by 13%. And to have an impact on a societal level, we need high efficacy, but we need something else also. If two people are using it, it's not going to be very effective on public health, so we need also the number effectiveness. And if we make a product of efficacy and effectiveness, we will see that snus has produced more cessation in Sweden than any other product. Sweden has also a record low level of smoking and record high level of snus use. What does Sweden's level of tobacco-related mortality look like? And now, this is important. That's really what counts. So I go to the, and Lars Romström, I should say, had used the Global Burden of Disease study here. I suppose it's the Gates Foundation that has supported this. And we see Sweden, as usual, Iceland is not here, doesn't count. Sweden is far to the left here with female percent of total deaths, but the males are lower than any other country. The Swedish females are not that low at all. They are about average with other females. So that's an interesting thing. There is an experiment in the culture, so you cannot say, oh yeah, it's the Swedes, it's the Swedish culture. But we have a control group there, women that hasn't used much, and men, which is the experimental group. What is Sweden's position regarding deaths from specific diseases for which snus has been suspected to be? Oral cancer, of course. So here we are looking at lip and oral cancer, oral cavity cancer. And the overall, the average across countries here is set to 1. In Portugal, poor Portuguese, 152. We go to Finland, a neighboring country, much, much lower, but Sweden, the lowest in oral cancer. And that's because smoking is a risk factor for oral cancer, alcohol and a couple of others. But Sweden is very low in oral cancer because there is little smoking, and snus obviously cannot cause massive numbers of oral cancer. It certainly can cause 1 or 2 or 3, but the frequency is too small to be a signal in the epidemiological studies. What about pancreatic cancer? There was some indications some time ago where particularly a study from Norway showed that there was an increased risk of pancreatic cancer. That study did not control for alcohol. I mean, the strongest risk factor for pancreatic cancer. And it wasn't Swedish news, it was an old Norwegian similar product called Skrå. So here Sweden is not the lowest, but second lowest in pancreatic cancer. So again, I'm repeating, snus can maybe cause one or two cases of pancreatic cancer, but the numbers are too small to be a signal in epidemiological studies. Nasopharynx cancer, Sweden is the next to the least country with nasopharynx cancer. You see it here. And poor Greek, this is no good. You have 58 times higher risk of getting nasopharynx cancer than the Swedes, according to the Global Burden of Disease study. Five point eight, sorry. That's big also.
Yeah.
Larynx cancer, the picture is very much the same. So I don't need to describe it so much again. So the summary of Lars Ramström, he actually sent me 30 handouts of his talk also, which is laying here. So if you would like to have one, please come up afterwards. In Sweden, increasing initiation of snus use has been accompanied by decreasing initiation of smoking and increasing proportion of non-initiation of tobacco use in general. Initial snus users appear to be recruited among prospective smokers rather than among prospective non-tobacco users. Otherwise, we would see a gateway effect. And what he hasn't included here is the smoking and snus prevalence among adolescents. Sweden is among the lowest country in smoking in adolescents also. Smokers have taken up daily snus use are significantly more likely to become smoke-free than those without uptake of snus. Almost a third of ex-smokers after uptake of snus have quit snus use and as well and become tobacco-free. And that refutes the myth that uptake of snus would lead to lifelong nicotine dependence. And the final slide, snus as self-administered aid for smoking cessation yields higher success rates than nicotine gum or patch among men. And actually, it has been discussed whether the OTC, over-the-counter classification and general sales that it is in many countries, most countries, if it really is effective at all. It probably is effective because those who go and ask for it are the heavier smokers, those who have more difficulties to quit. So because of they are heavier and more dependent, they seem to have no better results than those who do not use nicotine patches or gums, but there might be different populations. Among snus use is the most commonly used aid for smoking cessation. Among men, the combination of successfulness in individuals and large extent of use makes the public health effect big. Dual use is rather uncommon and appears to be a transient state. I'd like to make a personal comment here, so this is not Lars Ramström talking now. Dual use, in my mind, as far as I see it in Sweden, is a positive thing. In a smoker's clinic, we ask every smoker to quit abruptly because we don't want to be part of a tedious, gradually cut down. We don't simply have that resources. Set a quit date and you quit. But when smokers give up smoking in real life without any help and treatment, which happens to the most, they often reduce. And with snus, it's probably so that smoker A is smoking, sitting in the dinner, and the dinner is finished. Aren't we not going to smoke? Is there no one smoking here? Am I the only one that will go out on the porch and smoke? Not really. I see a can of snus. Let's try it. and there is a try, and they don't particularly like it, of course, because this is a special thing. It tastes very different. An e-cigarette is closer, so that's why the popularity, the same behavior engagement. So there is a use of a snooze. 2 weeks afterwards, he gets ill with a cold, bad cold, goes to the doctor. Are you smoking? Yes, I'm smoking. You got to give up smoking. Oh, so I buy a can of these and start to use them and start to get used to the product. And after some time, weeks, months, they can say goodbye to the cigarettes. But they need to be able to trust the product in a sense and like the product. So dual use can be the first steps. NRT, what is that? It's not completely stopping with nicotine. You cut up smoking in two steps. The first step being you leave the behavior, but you get the nicotine. And the second being you give up the nicotine. So it acts a little bit similar to nicotine replacement dual use of snus. So now I'm Ramström again. Snus favors public health both by decreasing initiation of smoking and by increasing cessation. Sweden, maybe Iceland, has Europe's lowest level of mortality attributable to tobacco, both with regard to deaths from all cancer causes and deaths from specific diseases for which snus has been suspected to be a major risk factor. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.